Considering the future of immigration policy. It is a big subject, but we want to share a lot of voices with you. Race Relations Commissioner Meng Foon is himself the son of immigrants. Kia ora, Meng, thanks for being with us. What's important to you for New Zealand's immigration policy in the future?
I think the immigration policies going into the future should actually be based on human rights and the Te Reti o Waitangi. Especially in the co-design of immigration policy going forward, because, you know, the Te Reti is an important part of our foundation and Māori need to actually be part of that design of policy.
How do we manage anti-immigrant sentiment?
Look, it's a very difficult thing. I think the thing is actually we all have a responsibility in creating the environment with the right conditions for immigrants to actually participate in community. But also, on the other hand, we need to actually make sure that our immigrants actually have the capability and capacity and the confidence in participating in New Zealand society. And therefore, I think there actually needs to be some pre-education in terms of what our country is. You know, it is a democracy. It is founded on the Te Reti o Waitangi. We do have same-sex marriage. We are diversity of many languages, many religion, the freedom of speech that comes with responsibilities based on human rights. And so we've got a good platform to actually work on.
So would that be a sort of the sort of thing that we offer to refugees who are settling in New Zealand?
Yeah, well, they actually, when they refugees come into the various settlement centres, they are actually taught and schooled up on New Zealand's life, how to actually be homemakers, how to actually participate in communities, albeit that is a short time. I think it's continuous education. I think we need to actually have organisations, PTEs, private training education providers, wānangas, whare wānangas, to actually provide those services for our community. There is a huge amount of voluntary organisations there, and I just want to acknowledge people like the Red Cross. They do a fantastic job in resettlement of our refugees. But then there are the refugees that come as, from family reunification. And I think that's where sometimes there is a little bit of breakdown in terms of knowledge of New Zealand and its processes and how do they actually get to participate in our society, and acknowledging that a refugee is different to a migrant. We are there also providing a humanitarian immigration here to New Zealand.
Ngā mihi ki a koe. Thank you very much. We appreciate your time. It is Race Relations Commissioner Meng Foon. I want to pick up on one of Meng's broader points there. Paul, you touched on this before. Social cohesion. We've seen anti-immigrant sentiment play some role in the likes of Brexit and in some of the political discourse in the United States. Is that a risk here?
Yes, absolutely. And I think during last year's general election, you began to see that risk begin to mount. And I think there are some parties, some individuals and some communities who feel very, very anxious about immigration. And when we develop the immigration policy going forward, we really need to take some of that opposition and some of that anxiety into account. Our own research shows that two things matter: education and contact. And so when you get away into those communities where there isn't contact with diversity, when there isn't contact with Tiwi Māori, for example, then you get that prejudice building up. So we've got to find ways to address that anxiety and to address that racism.
Now, I know that obviously one of the most high-profile political parties to call for a dramatic reduction in immigration numbers is New Zealand First. We had been planning to have Jenny Marcroft, former New Zealand First MP, here with us today, but she's had to pull out because of a last-minute family emergency. But Arthur, I know there will be people watching this who prickle at the suggestion that being anti-immigration is in any way xenophobic, and will say there are economic arguments that actually suggest we should reduce our immigration numbers. What's your response to that?
No, my response is that anti-immigration is being xenophobic. Most of the people who are strongly anti-immigration are xenophobic. And so I don't think there's actually
Is there any economic argument?
As I said before, the house prices in Auckland and Wellington are north of a million dollars?
The one area
where I think immigration has a negative impact on people is through house prices. It certainly doesn't have a negative impact on the labour market and jobs or employment, but it has an impact on house prices. If we had a proper, you know, decent housing supply through the country, we'd be able to overcome that. But the problem is surges in immigration. It's not the level of immigration. If you have, say, 100, 120,000 immigrants per year, which is our average sort of level, we can easily cope with that. It's when it surges by an extra 50,000 in a year, that's when housing and infrastructure and things can't keep up. So it's that, it's those surges that are hard. But it's also, for the reasons that Arama said, incredibly difficult to target these things in terms of net migration, because we don't control how many New Zealanders decide to leave. We don't know how, we can't control how many former immigrants decide to go back home, etc. So we don't know how many New Zealanders are going to return. So these, actually trying to target a figure on net migration is very difficult.
Oscar, does it matter where immigrants come from?
It shouldn't.
Does it?
It does, yeah. I mean, I'm sure those people that complain about house prices aren't talking about the Americans that are here buying houses or the people from the UK. You know, it's people with Asian-sounding names. But I can't stop thinking about something that the Commissioner said about how Te Tiriti has to be at the core. If we are going to have a reset, and I feel like this is a good opportunity, I agree with him that, you know, New Zealand can't even deal with the immigration from the rural areas to the urbans. And so we're trying to have this conversation about getting more people into our waka when there's so much that needs to be sorted out here. I feel like the onus should be on us to sort that quicker rather than saying, oh, it's too slow, we can't handle it. Because we're notoriously underinvestors, aren't we, in terms of the stuff that we need to do. Like, just take Auckland's stormwater drain pipes, over 100 years old, because no council, it's not sexy to campaign on fixing the drains.
No one likes rate rises.
Yeah.
Yeah. Adamar, I want to pick up on one of those points, and we're going to get to a discussion about the future and what a Tiriti-led immigration policy might look like a little later in the program. Do you think that migration in the last 15 years has been good for Māori?
Well, if we're talking about immigration in Māori, we should set a longer timeline. We have had a massive influx in recent years, but that's not the first time in our history where that's happened.
No.
Following the signing of the Treaty of Waitangi, there was a massive influx of people, and that was done with a specific intent to overwhelm Māori politically. Migrants coming to Aotearoa today are not here to take over. They're here to contribute to our society. And picking up on the point that we've been talking about here about cohesion, often, you know, people suggest that Māori might be really anxious about other people coming to Aotearoa and overwhelming us again. But some of the work that I've done looking at attitudes towards multiculturalism and Māori culture and how important it is for New Zealand's identity has shown that actually the broad Asian group, most of whom are born overseas, had more positive attitudes towards Māori culture than European New Zealanders. So I see this as something we should welcome and as great natural allies for Māori moving forward.
It's really interesting to note some of the demographic changes. And Paul, I think this came from your recent book. By 2030, at some stage, the number of New Zealanders who identify as being Asian New Zealanders will be at a par, at the same level, with the number of New Zealanders who identify as being Māori New Zealanders. What do you think the impact of that will be? And I appreciate that Asia as a geographic region is enormous.
Yes. And the category Asian itself is problematic because we're dealing with people that are enormously different, as a title like Pacifica does with the people from the Pacific. So I think what it does is it really reverses what we did in terms of a colonial history, where we excluded Asians and we were highly discriminatory at the border and once they'd come here. I mean, I don't know whether most people realise that Chinese couldn't become New Zealand citizens until 1951. So we've got a long history of racism towards migrants from Asia. So what I think it does is it opens up the opportunity when you've got both populations, both Maori and those Asian communities, is about 800,000, it opens up the opportunity of what New Zealand should look like in the 21st century. And it's not what we looked like 20 years ago, and it's certainly not what we looked like 50 years ago. So what does that new New Zealand look like? It's incredibly diverse. The Maori population is still growing, and it's still younger. And then alongside that, we've got these non-Pākehā populations, which are growing in size considerably, and that's despite COVID. I mean, COVID will halt that growth temporarily, but won't in the long term. And so that's a very, very different New Zealand.
Yeah.
What does it mean to be a New Zealander?